So we shall, without any ado, go on to our first speaker. Our first speaker is Dr. Tushar Grover, who is the director and consultant of Vision Eye Center and a consultant at Gangaram Hospital, New Delhi, a cataract, cornea, and refractive surgeon with a very good presence. Let's watch his challenging experience. Could you share your screen, Dr. Tushar?
Yes, ma'am. Is my screen visible?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. First of all, I'd like to thank ARC, Dr. Chitra ma'am, Dr. Harshal sir for the opportunity. Thank you so much for having me here. Thank you. So I'll be talking about issues that happen with femtosecond capsulotomy. And one of the common situations where this happens is when you have a small pupil. So something that usually works well is by cheating the machine a little bit. And we manually adjust the diameter of the pupil that the machine has detected and we increase it manually. And that usually works well. So we usually get an adequate size rexus, which is well within the pupil diameter on most instances. But sometimes this can go wrong, such as in this case, where once we took up the patient for surgery, we noticed that there was some pigment dispersion, which is why we stained this particular patient. And when you look at this case, it's quite evident that a part of the capsulotomy by the femtosecond laser has been done over the iris. So the energy has been delivered onto the iris. And quite evidently, there is an area of uncut capsulotomy. So in these situations, this can be quite tricky because you have that uncut area and it's possible that this can go peripherally. So it's important to be extremely gentle, extremely careful, and do a manual capsular excis here in this area. If we had micro forceps, that could have probably been made things a little easier. But with the regular capsular excis forceps, doing it very slowly and gently, we were able to satisfactorily complete the manual capsular excis here. And following that, we were able to take the capsule out. And this particular case was uneventful after that. Another situation where you can have these issues with capsulotomy is when you have white mature cataract. So we do usually increase the energy settings and increase the depth of the capsulotomy as well in white mature cataracts, because you can possibly have tags left behind, because there is some milky cortex that is released at the time of capsulotomy. And it's quite common to have some incomplete capsule tags left behind in white mature cataract. So that's why it's important to stain white mature cataract cases, even in femtocapsulotomy, because you want to be a little careful. And sometimes you have what looks like a complete rexus, but if you look carefully here, there is that uncut area of about 2 crocas. And if we were not careful, this could have gone peripherally. But sometimes in cases like this, where we have about a 6 clock hours of uncut capsulotomy, and we did manage to get a manual capsular excis, but as soon as we went in and we did the nucleus segmentation, we realized that the anterior capsule has gone posteriorly and there is a posterior capsular tear, which is quite large with drop of the contents. So it's important to be very careful with these first few steps in femtosecond laser, as we saw in these two cases. And it's important to remove the anterior capsule as if we were doing a manual capsular excis, so that in case there are any incomplete tags, we end up getting still a round circular complete rexus. And another initial step that's important to be careful with is the hydrodissection. So you have these air bubbles that are trapped posteriorly. So it's best to do a gentle rock and roll maneuver, bring up these posteriorly trapped air bubbles. And once you've done that, to do a gentle hydrodissection, important to be a little more gentle in these cases as compared to routine phacoemulsification. And as in routine cases, it's important to ensure nuclear rotation in these cases as well. So thank you so much. Thank you for the opportunity.
Yeah, that were wonderful take-home points you have shown in the challenges with the femtocataract platform beautifully. I'll start off with a question to you. Would you believe in having a pupil-maximized scan or a scanned capsular bag capsulotomy?
We usually do a pupil-maximized, ma'am. Unless you expect some amount of subluxation, then it makes sense to center onto the bag. But otherwise, usually pupil-maximized works well for us. So that is what we usually manage.
But actually doing a scanned capsule thing goes a great way, because you know, the images taken of both the anterior and the posterior capsule, and you know, you will center it on the equator.
True.
And any in the expert panel could also answer this question, which I'm not sure who all are there. Mohan, I think you're there, no?
Yes.
Could you tell which type of total cataract, total cataracts would you expect uncut capsulotomies on a femtosecond laser? And when would you not do a nucleotomy at all in these cases? Which of these?
All the total cataracts, you need to be make sure that there are skip areas will be there. Please understand this. All types, whether it's a type 1, type 2, or type 3 cataracts, you have to look for skip areas. Don't pull out the capsule, because it is never a free floating capsule. Always there is some attachment. So do it like a regular exercise, what Tushar has shown that. And near total cataracts, if you see the OCT scan, you can see the OCT scan. If it scans the entire lens, you can cut through the lens as well. You can do the nucleotomy also. And what my cutoff for the small pupil is about 5.7 millimeter. If the pupil is 5.7 millimeter, then your excess will be 1 millimeter less than that. Okay, about 4.7 millimeter. Beyond 5.7 millimeter, if I'm able to see, if the pupil doesn't dilate, then I will not do femto for these patients. So my cutoff is about 5.7 millimeter, because I need a good offset for that also. Skip areas always look for, because otherwise they can tear and go to the posterior capsule as well.
Dr. Rohit?
Please unmute yourself, Dr. Rohit.
I think it was very nicely presented videos which Dr. Tushar did. What Dr. Mohan Rajan has said, I think tripe and blue staining is a very important part in this. And because with the help of tripe and blue staining, it becomes the anterior capsule becomes absolutely clear. And then you have to lead yourself in it. You have to, when you are putting in the visco, you have to be very careful about it, because if you put in the visco and you don't put the capsular axis flap back, it can cause, if you take it across, at times it can extend to the periphery. So you have to place it there, and then you have to see, because there are many skip areas in these. So these skip areas have to be taken care of.
Actually, it's because of the increased intraluminal pressure in some of these total intraluminal cataracts. So, as soon as you puncture it, the level where the laser hits is changed because of the fluid thing. And if it's a total opaque white cataract, you do not do the nucleotomies at all. You could do it with a total brown cataract. But in a white cataract, it's opaque, so the laser cannot pass through. And at the other area of a total cataract where you would not do, which you rarely see, is again a total Morganian cataract, where the nucleus is the capsular bag, or you cannot be sure how the capsular bag, anterior and posterior capsular bag are. Yes, Namrata?
Yeah. So in the Morganian also, if you change the offset, you can probably do it.
Yeah.
And I would even do it for a total cataract. It's a different thing that, it may or may not cut as much as I would have liked to.
Yes.
I'd also like to ask Dr.
Chitra. No, I want to add one thing, Chitra, here.
Yeah.
You'll be surprised to find that on the scan, that these cataracts cut also.
Yes.
So don't underestimate the catalyst laser, especially because it can cut even through a mature cataract. I've seen nucleus division all the way up to the posterior capsule, even in almost near total cataracts.
Near total brown cataracts more than in white.
Even cataracts. Even white cataracts also I've seen. It cuts.
Dr. T from Singapore has shown there's almost a 17.2% chance of an incomplete capsulotomy in white cataracts, especially Morganian, and greater the lens thickness, greater is the chance of incomplete capsule.
Yeah, but that is not the issue, because with the closed chamber, there is no pressure dynamics. So you are able to create a partial one, but when you go in, there is hardly any incidence when you end up with a extension beyond to the periphery. So if you are careful with those skip areas and staining and adequately managing with the visco, you really have an extension to the periphery.
Yes.
Yeah.
Harshal,
Dr. Chitra, I wanted to add one big thing. Dr. Chitra.
Yes, sir.
I just wanted to add about Tushar's one case, the first one where you were showing the small pupil thing. So, you know, you should switch off the, you can switch off the on the screen there where it shows where the rexis is going to happen. You can switch it off when the rexis is happening. Otherwise, you can miss where it's actually firing, you know, because it gets camouflaged under that. And if it's coming too close to the pupil, you can stop at that point, because otherwise you'll go onto the iris. That's one thing. And because of the meiosis, which happens, you know, I would never want to go too close, intraoperatively with any of the lasers. Actually, some meiosis does happen. Third thing, you know, while you were doing that rexis, I felt that if you could put viscoat to, you know, push the pupil away, you could have had better visualization where you wanted to tear. You know, you were going right under the pupil and very close to it. So either viscoat or something like a viscomydriasis, or maybe even a small single iris hook there too, because the template is already there probably. And, you know, when you're tearing, if you can see where you're going, might have helped. Otherwise, you handle it so beautifully, Tushar.
Very good. Yeah. But I still wish that you, in these cases, you go through the side port and don't open your main incision at all.
Right.
Some amount of anterior chamber shallowing could also cause it to run away sometimes. Right.